Hello, young people of Canada. I wish I could be with you live, but I'm currently at COP 27 in Egypt. COP stands for the Conference of the Parties, meaning the leaders of the world. In this United Nations initiative of COP for climate change, these annual international gatherings are essential to bring the entire planet on board to fight climate change with actions that will eventually reduce the greenhouse gases that are responsible for the planet warming. In 2015, COP gave us the important Paris Agreement that aims to keep global warming below 2 degrees Celsius, with efforts to keep it below 1.5 degrees. Right now, we are at 1.5 increase average temperature since Industrial Revolution. Last year, we saw several initiatives to make sure that the world adequately finances the transitions, because we know that the places where we put our efforts, put our money, this will progress. So more than ever now, countries, companies, organizations across the world are pledging to become net zero before by 2050 or before. We want to make sure that the rules are clear about exactly what it means to get to net zero and set strict standards, so like everybody, we all align in the same directions and we attain the pledges.
Thank you. And I say you should hold the senator to that commitment and make sure you meet with her, because she'll certainly have some interesting insights for you from COP27. And I think it's a great segue into what I was wanting to share with you, because at Save the Children, we have been working for 103 years as an international non-government organization focused on children's rights. And a huge part of our work is forums like this, where we actually work with children and young people and get your perspectives. And we also recognize where that doesn't happen, and it doesn't happen in so many forums. And I think ahead of COP27, we really wanted to speak to children and present those views to decision makers like the senator ahead of the event in Egypt. So Save the Children actually surveyed 54,000 children and youth in 15 countries, and that included 1,200 here in Canada. And I think it's a good way to start the conversation, because 88% of those children and youth said that they had seen or experienced either the impacts of climate change or inequality or both in their communities. And the intersection between those is really important, because we know that the effects of climate change are being felt most by those who haven't contributed to it. Optimistically, the report was called Generation Hope, because so many of the children we spoke to have hope that we can still make change, that their futures will be secured. And I feel the same way. And I do increasingly so when I have conversations with young leaders like those on the call today. But 84% of that group said we have to work together in order to actually see significant change. I think that means the young, the old, the rich, the poor, the decision makers, and those, you know, that don't have a voice. And all of our work around climate change is really striving to bring those groups together and to make sure that all those voices are heard. I've just come from a full day today of training on anti-racism and anti-oppression that all of our Save the Children leaders are doing, because we really, our commitment to all the work we do is also to address the root causes of so much of this work, which is racism and inequality. So with that, I'd like to thank you for inviting me to this conversation. But I'd like to hear from our young leaders today and hand over to all of you to introduce yourselves and give us a bit of context about this conversation. I was with you on Monday, which was great. Thanks for that. But good for us to hear again some of the burning issues for you today.
Hi, my name is Olivia Gillespie. I'm 16 and I'm a grade 11 high school student from Ontario. And here with me is Oswaldo. He was from the gender-based violence group, and Katie, who I know she was in like the climate change group last year. So I just wanted to start by thanking everyone who's here, because I know like we've had a lot of these meetings recently, but I know like this is obviously really important and it needs to be done. So I'm glad like everyone's here, everyone's like very actively like participating and recognizing how important listening and working towards solving the climate crisis. So the advocacy program started last year, November 2021. I got involved because I'm part of an equity club at my school. So they sent around an invite to join this or just apply to the youth advocacy program. And I thought, oh, this would be cool. This would look cool on a resume. And I didn't really know what it was. But then we joined and we started making these groups for advocacy issues like BIPOC rights, healthcare equity. And I chose climate change because it's always been something I've been passionate about talking about. And just like, I always thought like the discussions were really interesting. So I joined a group and there were six of us. And we decided to like come up with some like recommendations and just talk about the importance of sharing how important and how urgent solving the climate crisis is and everybody doing their part to help. So we came up with recommendations for youth, adult allies, and decision makers. So there was like recommendations tailored to like each group. So for the youth, we said to use your voice. We have a voice for a reason. We're the ones who the climate crisis will affect the most in the future because this is a planet that we are going to live on. So to participate in all of the events, in all the rallies and all the protests that we have, to just participate, because even if you're just showing up, showing that you're there shows everyone you care, shows that you're support, and it shows that this is an issue that we care about and this is like a really pressing matter that we need to attend to. And then for adults, it was just to help support those young people because it's not always an easy conversation to have. And we're just trying to make a better world for the future. So to support and vote for those environmental friendly policies and things like that. And then for decision makers, we said also listen to the youth because we're all speaking about this for a reason. And one of the ones that someone came up with was make public transportation more sustainable, accessible, and environmental friendly, because that's something small, but something we can all do. Yeah, that's it.
Great, thank you. Katie and Oswaldo, are you giving your remarks now, or we're taking your questions a bit later?
Well, from my side, I don't think that
I think they have questions for me.
Okay, great. So Olivia, you've said it all. Thank you so much. And now let's hear from Commissioner DeMarco for your opening remarks, and then we'll put you on the hot seat a bit later.
Well, thank you for inviting me, and thank you, Terrence, for the land acknowledgement, and Danny for the introduction, and for all of you for attending this evening. I'm very pleased to be speaking with you today, or this evening, because it is getting dark, as you mentioned. And I hope you've enjoyed your experience in the program. Climate change is both an immediate and an intergenerational crisis, and it requires, as I think has already been said by Danny, a whole of society response to protect present and future generations of humans and all of the other species with which we share the planet. Part of my motivation for a career in the environmental protection field came from the sad story of the extinct passenger pigeon, which was once North America's most common bird. When I thought of the passenger pigeon's demise, I could not help but feel a sense of resentment over what previous generations had done. I didn't know anything about climate change back then, but it is now evident that the capacity of the present and recent generations of humankind to damage the environment has moved to a much larger scale. Our destructive actions are now threatening human and non-human life all across the planet. You know, I used to say that young people, such as yourselves on this call, are the next generations of leaders and decision makers. But in preparing these remarks and reading the document that you've put together and released this week, I realized that sentence is no longer completely accurate. You're not just the next generation of leaders, you're already leaders. And you are not just lamenting environmental loss like some of us did in our youth, but you're taking action to counter it. And you should be congratulated for doing that. That's one of the reasons I find it so important to hear directly from you on the issue of climate change this evening. I've had a look at the Reimagine playbook, and Olivia just summarized the recommendations quite well. So thank you for that. A very impressive document, and I look forward to learning more about the work you've been doing during tonight's discussion. I want to leave as much time as possible for the discussion, so I'm going to be fairly brief in describing the work I do as the Commissioner of the Environment and Sustainable Development. But if you want me to fill in more details later, I'm happy to do that. But I'll just do a brief overview for now, in the interest of getting to the discussion item on our agenda. So the position of the Commissioner within the Office of the Auditor General of Canada was created by federal law back in 1995. And our office serves Parliament directly by providing it with objective, fact-based information and expert advice on government programs and activities gathered through our audits. Much of our work involves auditing or evaluating the performance of the federal government. And as Commissioner, my specific role within the office is to provide parliamentarians and Canadians with objective, independent analysis and recommendations on the federal government's efforts to protect the environment, to mitigate the effects of climate change, and to foster sustainable development. Some of our recent audit reports pertaining to climate change include carbon pricing, just transition, climate-ready infrastructure, hydrogen, and the Emissions Reduction Fund. We also published a broader report called Lessons Learned from Canada's Record on Climate Change, with the hope of avoiding a repeat of the mistakes of the past. It gives a historical perspective on three decades of Canadian action and inaction on climate change. Finally, before we get to the discussion, I'd like to highlight the environmental petitions process, which you can find out more about on our website. Petitions are a way to bring concerns about environmental and sustainable development issues directly to the attention of the federal government. Only one signature is required, even though it's called a petition. Only one signature is required to submit one, and petitioners receive a direct formal response from the responsible federal minister. And our office reports on petitions every year to Parliament, and it's something that you can consider using in your work. I'll stop there so that we can spend lots of time on discussion.
Great. Thank you so much, Commissioner. I think now we go to pause our recording. Is that right? We treated like the emergency that it was. You know, we were in during COVID, we were confined to our homes. You know, the systems changed. Everything changed in our world. We treated it like the crisis that it was. And if climate change is truly a crisis, we're not acting that way. You know, I was listening to a podcast the other day, and I forget the guy's name. He's an environmentalist. He said, you know, in World War II, when Pearl Harbor happened and the U.S. joined the war, the day the U.S. joined the war, I think it was Ford, stopped making vehicles from that day for the next 4 years for public, for sale. They turned everything they were doing to the war effort and to the crisis at hand, you know, and I think we don't think of climate change in that way, like a war, like a pandemic, and maybe it's time we do. I mean, and I think, you know, to transition to the advocacy piece, a lot of our advocacy at Save the Children is trying to show the urgency of the situation, especially when it comes to so many of the countries in which we work, where it is really urgent. Thinking about Pakistan, where, you know, a third of the country was underwater this year. And, you know, imagine being a child in that situation. There's nothing more urgent. So I'm rambling already, but I want to give in the last 2 minutes, Katie, Oswaldo, Olivia, if you're there, Khadija, you know, please throw me a question if there's anything that you wanted on advocacy or communications or what we're doing at Save the Children.
I just had a quick one. You're very like passionate about like advocacy, and like you're at like a very high level for obviously where you are right now. I was just wondering, like, how did you get into like being like, what led you to be like in this field? Like, why is there like a story, or you just thought it was like wanted to help people?
That's a lot. It's a big question with 1 minute to go. But what I'll tell you is I actually just did a podcast this week with a guy called Aaron, and it's the Simbi podcast, and it was an hour long podcast. And when it comes out, I'll send it to you, because he asked me, it was about my personal story as well. I started out my career as a journalist and spent many years working in parts of Africa and the Middle East. And I don't know what the genesis of my, you know, I don't have a story, one thing that happened to me, but I grew up in a single mom home with, my mom had four kids. And, you know, I saw the inequality just in her life and in her just trying to get by. And I also am gay, you know, and growing up as a gay teenager and struggling with my sexuality and the unequal bits of that. I don't know. I don't even know if that's what drove my passion for social change or something else. But I've been working in social change my whole life, and advocacy is a big part of that. I mean, every career I've had involves storytelling in some way to try to get people to pay attention to these important issues. And it always has boggled my mind that more people don't pay attention to inequalities in our world, but they don't until they come to their doorsteps. And I feel like to tie this all up, I mean, climate change is at our doorstep now, and we don't really have the ability to ignore it anymore. So I think we need to all keep telling stories, and all of you keep your passion for this issue, because it impacts all of our lives in so many ways. And I would not be the diligent moderator that I am with and not tie this up on time. But I do have a couple more minutes. I can stay for another 5 minutes if that's helpful. If not, I'm more than happy to leave my email in the chat, and you can connect with me in other ways to keep in touch.
That was a really good answer. Thank you.
Yeah, I think we'd be hard pressed to beat that to wrap things up, Danny. So thank you okay. so much. I just want to say it's really interesting to, you know, UNICEF and Save the Children, two organizations that are known for their work internationally, to be coming together and talking to young people in Canada really shows, and to the Commissioner, Environmental Commissioner of Canada, really shows how the issue of climate change is really breaking down borders and making it relevant to all of us. So thank you to all the young people on the call. Thank you, Danny, for your excellent job moderating. I agree, we probably need to find another time for you to speak to some of our youth advocates about the work you're doing. And a special thank you in particular to Commissioner DeMarco for joining us this evening and sharing your insights. And thank you for all the work you're doing in your role. And with that, I think we'll close. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you so much.